now for the 45 degrees?
Two or two.
And the same, then pi over 3.
Like 60 degrees.
What? Three pi over 2 is an angle in radians. I got the little circle here. 3 pi over 2 is just the angle down here. The angle we're looking at is pi over 3 or 60 degrees. And it's going to be right there. So how do you find the tangent? Sine over cosine. So the square root of 3 over 2 divided by 1 half. Square root of 3. Divided by 1 half plus, well, we don't have a reciprocal, right? So times 2 over 1, 2 cancel, so square root of 3. Okay? So of course this is, should be kind of old news. We know about that. We know that our unit circles will allow us to find the trig values of the angles that we've taken the sine to the angle. Every angle has a sine, cosine, tangent. Well, let's say with sine and cosine. All of them have angles. They all have sines and cosines, okay? And the thing we're going to learn about today is just the going in the other direction, the inverse function of the sine, cosine, tangent, okay? So all that means is that instead of saying the sine of 30, we're going to, it's like starting with 30 as the input, right? We know about functions and how you input things and how you input things. So instead of putting 30 into the sine function and getting out 1 half, we'll get away with 1 half to about 30. Okay? So maybe if you're not quite sure, it doesn't quite, you know, all of the sense to you. I'm just going to have you very similar, but now you're not going to the angle and the sine and the cosine. You're looking for a sine or a cosine, and so this angle has that. So find an angle that has a sine of 1 half. Thirty degrees. We're in radians, pi over 6 radians. Right? Right? Is that our answer?
Yeah.
Satisfied? Okay. How about an angle that has a cosine of root 2 over 3? 45 degrees. About an angle that has a tangent of root 3.
60 degrees.
Does that sound familiar, right? Because those are the angles that I just gave to you and asked you to find the sine and cosine. So this is the basic idea of the inverse sine, inverse cosine, and inverse tangent. Okay? So to say this, find an angle that has a sine of 1 half. All of that is being said by this expression right here. If I wanted say what that is. We want to figure out what that's worth. Sine to negative 1 is an inverse sine of 1 half, which means find an angle that has a sine of 1 half. So when we write this, cosine of negative 1, we're saying the inverse cosine of root 2 over 2. That means find an angle that has a cosine of root 2 over 2. What's that look like? I'm looking for a circle. I'm looking for a sine, a cosine of root 2 over 2. These are the cosines right here. Root 2 over 2, that angle has a cosine of root 2 over 2. And this one, find an angle that has a tangent of root 3. Okay, that was a little trickier because we have to go around the unit circle, take sines, divide by cosine, and see if we come out with the square root of 3. But we already did that work over here. So that's how I did it. A little bit easier on you. So, that's called the inverse tangent. The inverse tangent says, you know, notice these two bubbles here. This guy is saying, find an angle that has a tangent of the square root of 3. So we do it. So, pretty simple.
The only thing is, it's not that simple.
Listen, when I ask you to find a sine of 1/2 and tell me what angle that is, there's still a bit of trickiness that doesn't happen over here. If I say to go to pi over 6 and tell me what the sine is, it's just 1/2. But if I say find an angle that has a sine of 1/2, what's the unit of 1/2? Well, this has a sine of 1/2. But are there other angles that have sine of 1/2? Well, this angle has a sine of 1/2. And let's say I start at 30 and I go around 360 degrees, that coterminal angle, 390 degrees, it also has a sine of 1/2. And if I start here and I go 360 degrees, that's going to be 510 degrees. Well, that also has a sine of 1/2. So when I say inverse sine of 1/2, and I just describe it as what angle has a sine of 1/2, there's a lot of answers. Well, that's a problem.
Because you want them to be functions.
And what's an important thing about functions? Yeah, for every input, there's only one output. Yeah? Only one answer, only one result. Okay. So without really being more specific, if I just say inverse sine of 1/2, it just means go the opposite way of the sine function. Sine function, take an angle, tell me the sine. Inverse sine, take the sine value and tell me the angle. See how we flip the input and the output. That's exactly what the inverse function does. Flip the input and the output. Okay, so that's why right now we kind of need to say only get your answers from a certain part of the unit circle. We're going to change the range of the function, change the output of the function. So it's not unlimited. So that's why if you look on the first page of 13.4, you're going to see the very first page, big rectangular things, these two concepts, and it's got all this stuff, pictures of the unit circle, shaded with different regions. The reason why you'll see this in the book, you know, a little unit circle like that, and this side is shaded, is because we want to avoid this, where, well, this has a sine of 1/2, and this has a sine of 1/2, and if we go 360 degrees around, that has a sine of 1/2, and 360 more degrees, that has a sine of 1/2. How many angles have a sine of 1/2? Infinite number. I can just keep whatever angle stops here, 30 degrees, 390 degrees, another 360 to that, and we got 6, 7, 15 degrees. Like, all of these angles all end right here, all the terminal signs right there, and well, that makes the inverse sign not. So to make it a function, you say forget about 390, forget about 750, forget about negative 330, forget about all those other angles. The only angle that will be like the answer to inverse sine of 1/2 will be 30. We'll see that. Okay. And so now we want every possible input to have an output. Right? Like when I put in the square root of 2 over 2 in the inverse sine, and I say the inverse sine of square root of 2 over 2, I want them to have a result, and I want them to have one result. I want them to have one output, not several, not infinite. Okay? So since it's convenient, it's kind of a small angle, we'll say that the only answer for this will be, what do you think? 45. No other one. Even though 135 degrees also has a sine of 1/2, and so do any other angles that are coterminal with either of those angles. We'll just say only 45. 45 is in this range. Between this angle and that angle. Okay. Let's test you out and see if you get the idea here. How about the inverse sine of negative square root of 3 over 2? Try to see if I can get the one to follow the pressure. What's that?
150
degrees?
140? 140?
And, well, okay, so if you look at 240 and you look at 300, they both have the sign that the second value, that y value, is negative 2 over 3, both of them. Okay. But for one thing, 240 is right here, right? Not in the shade of the right? Okay. So 300 is in that shade of the but that's not the angle that we say is the inverse sine of that. Because, well, I'll I'll tell you, first of all, that is an angle that has a sine of negative root 3 over 2. And you can see this when you look at it. But if that's the angle that we say, if we say 300 degrees, then we, like, here are all the angles for positive sine, and then this has a pretty empty space. We don't use any of these angles. Skip all of those angles, and then we use all these angles from 270 to 360. So then kind of the output has this big gap that we don't use. So rather than that, we'll say from 0 to 90, the 0 to pi root 2, we'll use those for sines of the inverse sines of positive values. Inverse sine of 1 half, inverse sine of the 2 over 2, inverse sine of the 2 over 2 will all come from 0 to 90. Okay. If we get negative signs, then we'll come back this way. Right? This is the negative direction. We get a negative 90 degrees. So the output of this function, which is an angle, those angles will be less than 90 degrees and bigger than negative 90 degrees. That makes sense? So if I say inverse sine of negative 3 over 2, I say 300 degrees does have a sine of negative 3 over 2. We don't do that just because it's not as nice as if we just go down to negative 90. It's not nice because if we go past 90 degrees, skip all of these angles, not use any of those, and then start using these angles here. Big gap. So that we eliminate that gap, we'll go from 0 to 90, use those, and then we'll just come back this way. So we have this nice continuous range. Okay. So, range inverse sine of x we use this part of the circle, we'll use this range. I would say that because I see nobody or maybe one person writing to do that. Take notes. So then, what is the inverse sine of negative 3 over 2? Negative 60. Negative 60 degrees, or in radians, negative pi over 2. And what's the inverse sine of negative 1? What's that? Yeah, inverse sine of negative 1. What angle has the sine of negative 1? Except 270, it goes from here all the way around and there. We would have
negative 90.
Yeah, negative 90. I have a 2 of her radians. Okay. Another one that might trick you, or at least confuse you, the inverse sine of, let's say, 2. Is that?
Normal
90 as a sine of 2? What is the sine of 90?
1.
What's that?
Lapping
it around twice, except for remember that the sine, like we built a circle and then we said that like the sine of any of the angles anywhere, like even if you lap around twice, is y over r. So if we lap around twice, the vertical component here, the y, is still 1. We still get, for the sine of 90, that would be 1 over 1, and that's still 1. And even the sine, if I go around twice, still it would be 1 over 1. What do we make of the inverse sine of 2? And it doesn't exist. It doesn't make any sense. There is no inverse sine of 2. Because the biggest sine that you'll find is what?
1.
The biggest sine you'll find is 1 at 90 degrees. I have 2 radians. So we are going to limit the angles that are the outputs. Okay, put a little note there. The inputs would be values that, you know, sine, obviously, angle. So the angle values are going to go between negative 90 and 90. So the input x needs to be
2, 0, and 1.
Definitely smaller than 1. Think of bigger than 1. Inverse sine of 2 doesn't make sense. Inverse sine of 3 doesn't make sense. Could be smaller than 0, though. What? Negative. We could go all the way down. So this function, the inverse sine function, things you put in for x doesn't make any sense to put in like negative 2 or negative 5 or anything smaller than negative 1 because there are no angles that have sine that are smaller than negative 1. And it wouldn't make sense to put anything in there that's bigger than 2. And the y part of it is not so much that it doesn't make sense, but it's in order to make it a function that only has one output, we only will have y values, we'll only have outputs that are from negative 90 to 90. So we'll get into the inverse, cosine, inverse, tangent here in a second. But let's evaluate a sine that's not on our unit circle. Let's see if we can do that. The inverse sine of 1.3. How about the inverse sine of 0.3? And look around your unit circle, you're not going to find any signs that say 0.3, right? Or 3/10 or anything like that. So what do you think? So what is?
There is less
than 1. So less than 1. So it is valid. There is some angle out there that has a sine of 0.3. Some angle out there has a ratio, like maybe this one right here, of 3 to 10 as the ratio of that, 0.3 to 1. So how do we figure out what that is? How do we do it? Like if I wanted you to take the sine of 17 degrees, how do we do that? That's what the sine of 17 degrees was. Now hold on just a second. Let's make a guess at what this angle is going to be. Do you think it's going to be like 1 degree or 2 degrees, 10 degrees, 30 degrees? Think about the sign you know. You know, like a half. Not 10. 3 degrees? Let's, 120? Oh, 20, just 20. Or 120. But remember that the angles will always come out of either 0 to 90, 120 is way over there.
Yeah.
So either 0 to 90 or negative 90 degrees, somewhere in here. The 120 would be over there, that's not going to be 1 degree.
Why less than 30?
Why less than 30? Sine's 1/2, sine is the vertical part of the end of that line. The sine is this vertical one, okay? So the vertical part of each of these coordinates is the sine. This is 1/2. 0.3 is less than 1/2. So we're going to be less than 30. Okay. So 15. 15. 15. calculators. Do you see the inverse sign there? It's right above the sign, and the second button to get to it. Let's see if we can find out if our gap is all right. Anybody get anything other than an output of 17.5? Possible, but I don't want to be sure we discuss why. 17.4?
17.45.
So if you round it to 10th place, 17.5. Or 0.5. What's that? What'd you get?
0.3.
0.3. Now, how can you get 0.3 if it puts in the same thing? In radians. It's giving just like we needed to tell the calculator, hey, I'm in radians, to take the sine of pi over 2, like in radians, not degrees. If you want your output to be in degrees, you need to be in degrees. If you want your output to be in radians, you need to go to the radian mode. So that would be what, 0.2?
0.5.
0.5?
0.1.
Oh, 0.3. 0.3?
Yeah.
0.3 radians. I don't really need the right radians. I just need not put it in degrees in the way. But, 0.3 radians, 17.5 degrees. And let's do this. Just one more. Then we'll actually use it. Guess real quick before we actually plug this in. Where is that negative? Hold on, don't do it yet. I want to just make a guess. What's your guess? What angle do you think will have a sign of negative 0.78? Somewhere around negative 60. My guess, since we move forward. And the inverse sign is right above the sign. Yeah, I put in negative 78, not negative 50. I don't know. Negative 51. Closer to 60 than 30. Yeah. So negative 0.51. So now let's create somewhat. Scenario where we would use the inverse sign for something. Get ourselves a right triangle here. And say that this is 5, 7, and okay. It's different from the kinds of problems we've done before. Before we've been given like an angle and a side and then a sign for the side, but now we're supposed to find an angle. We don't have any other angles except that 90 degrees. Well, you know that vertical side is 5 and the hypotenuse is 7. So what do we know about that angle? The sine of this angle is 5 over 7. So we're looking for whatever we're looking for. It says find an angle. Kind of language that I use in that front page. Find an angle that has a sine of whatever, that's the inverse sine of that. Sine of 5 7. saying, and I know we've got it, so.
Forty-five?
Point five eight. .55, .58. So now we've got, this is 45.58, and so this angle would be what?
.4, .4 feet.
.4, .4 feet. Because we know that all of these angles have to add up to 80, so make sure that that happens. And you find this side, or how would you find this side? Value 5 and 7, the Pythagorean theorem, 7 squared equals a. Squared, 5 squared, so 49 minus 25, 8 squared, that's going to be 24. So a equals 24. Draw another triangle. This angle, this is the cosine. Okay, so you're thinking kind of ahead of the game here. The inverse, well, the cosine of this angle is 3/10. So how do we find the angle? We're looking for an angle that has a cosine of 3/10. Find an angle with a cosine of 3/10. If we didn't think of the inverse cosine, think, imagine the inverse sine is the only tool that we have. Can we use the sine? Find that angle? For 10, like, the only thing we know about is the inverse sine of 10. We didn't think about using the inverse cosine. Okay. Can you do the inverse sine of some of that angle? Does that go around about right?
Yeah.
Pythagorean theorem to find this side, and now you have the opposite of that function. Another way? So you can find this angle, and then that angle for this angle. Different ways to think about it. But the inverse cosine is what I wanted to get to. So we talk about the inverse cosine, talk about the parts of the circle that we find the angle for the stuff that we talked about for the inverse sine. So y equals inverse cosine of x. Oh. That means find an angle that has a cosine of whatever. So let's try and put it a little bit more concrete. So inverse cosine of 1/2. What's the inverse cosine of 1/2? But then again, we run into that same problem where also 300 degrees has a cosine of 1/2. And so does 360 plus 60, so 420 degrees? No. Yeah. 420 degrees. This is all of these other angles that have cosines of 1/2. So then you limit the angles that we're going to use in these certain angles. So what do you think it should be? Should be from negative 90 to 90, just like inverse sine? So if we use from negative 90 to 90, then we just kind of, that's not a very good idea. So then we just have 60, and then we also have, like, we just have doubles. We just have two angles that have, so that's no good. How about 0 to 90? Is that a good part of it?
Yeah, 0 to 90.
And it go all the way to 180, because over here we find all the other cosines of the negative cosine. Make sense? Okay, so for the inverse cosine, we're not going to stick over here like the inverse sine, we're going to go from here to there. For the inverse cosine. So the angles that we get for the inverse cosine are going to be from 0 to 180, or from 0 to pi of the final radius. All right, so now that we've limited the range, we've made it into a function, meaning it only has one output for every input. So now, what's the inverse cosine of 1 pi?
63.
63's pi of the 2 radians. What's the inverse cosine of negative root 3 over 2?
150 degrees.
The cosines of the x values, this guy right here is cosine of negative root 3 over 2, so 150 degrees of this. Inverse cosine of negative 2. There isn't one. There is no angle that has a cosine of negative 2. Just like the sine, there's no angles that have cosines that are less than negative 1 or...
Are they all linear things with that?
Are you, like, does it also apply to this angle?
Yeah.
No. So the range, we're describing the range, the outputs, x, the function, or the inverse cosine, is going to be somewhere between negative 1 and 1. And remember, these are all trig ratios, these are ratios, and from the cosine and the sine, it wouldn't make any sense for these ratios to be bigger than 1 or less than negative 1. Same is not true for this angle. Any questions about inverse sine or inverse cosine? Five out of five on the understanding. So we're looking for an angle with
a tangent
of 7 over 5, or the inverse tangent of 7 over 5.
Four, six degrees.
Does this sound believable? 4.46?
Yeah.
What makes it sound believable to you? Maybe let's just look at the triangle, like 7 and 5. They're kind of close to each other, right? They're not so far, they're like 30 and 3. 75 mechanic close. If these were both, say, 7, what angle would that be? 45. That's something we know about 45 90 triangle. They're kind of close, but this side's bigger than this side. They're kind of close, but this side's bigger, and so this angle would need to be bigger than 45. Too much bigger, 54.46 is bigger, but not too much bigger. About like 80 degrees. I believe it. I like for everyone, the students and just everybody in the world, to get healthy in place where they just got. Does that make sense? Does that answer make sense? Yeah, that makes sense. Okay. So, can I put in something, this is what Chance is asking, you know, for the inverse tangent, do we have to stick between negative 1 and 1? No, I just drew a triangle and found that the tangent was 7 divided by 5. 7 divided by 5 is bigger than 1, right? Let's see how big we can get the tangent to be. Say that this is 10 and this is 5. Now the tangent of this angle is what?
2.
Okay, now this. Here's the angle. This is 30 and this is 2. The tangent of this angle? 15. What's the limit for this? Where do I have to stop? How big of a tangent can I make? Big as you want. Here's an easy way to make the tangent as big as I want. Let's get right here. I'll make this side 1, the angle. I'll make this side whatever I want the tangent to be. Right? Be 5 trillion, whatever, over 1. So the tangent can be as big as it wants to be. It has no limit. It goes off to infinity. And in the negative direction, you know, we could make those sides negative, like make this triangle down like this, make this side 1. And we can make this negative. And so this angle has a negative 1. So the tangent's unlimited. What a tangent can be. So we could find the inverse tangent of 1,000, inverse tangent of 1,000,000, inverse tangent of 900,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000,000, one?
Oh, you know, quadrant three.
Quadrant three, I get it divided by negative. Do you want to just jump to quadrant three when you could just choose quadrant one? No, I think it's just a matter of preference. Now, it is the agreed upon thing today, where we get our positive tangents, or when we say the inverse tangent of 5/7, that is going to be an angle from the first quadrant. What is that angle?
It must be.
So now the question is, where do we get our negative tangents? Where do we find negative tangents? Fourth quadrant. Where else will we find negative tangents? Second quadrant. Here we've got positive sines and negative cosines. Here we have positive cosines and negative sines. Either one of these is going to give us a negative tangent. So which one do we go with? You like the bottom right one? Do you want to go from negative 90 to 90? That's what you think. You think 0 to 180.
Well,
we're going to have to decide which one do we go with, which one is nicer. Okay. Turns out the one that's nicer is the fourth quadrant. This from negative 90 to 90. That winds up being it. It winds up that for the inverse tangent, it has the same range as the inverse sine. You go from negative 90 to 90. Now let's see why we would rather do that than go from 0 to 180. What is the tangent of 90 degrees? How did we get that? Cosine is 0, and inside of one side, where cosine is equal to 0. There's no problem with that? Dividing by 0 has no definite. It's a weird thing that happens sometimes. We try to divide by 0, and there's just no way to talk about it. This number cannot be. It just can't be a definition in the real number system or any other made-up number. The square root of negative 1, we were able to make imaginary numbers and they kind of work together and cool things happen and you try to multiply them together and add them together and that was a system that works. But when you try to have numbers divide by 0, it just doesn't work out the same. If you can divide 1 by 0, basically that could be anything you want and 1 could be equal to 2 and everything is all cool. If 1 divided by 0 were something, then 2 divided by 0 would be, you could show that it may be same thing, so 1 and 2 would be the same. Not true. So it's undefined. Can't divide by 0. So if we did go from 0 to 180, we would have this one angle right smack dab in the middle of the range that doesn't have a tangent. Right? So it would be like this blank spot where we don't get an output. Right? And we would have two places here and there that have a tangent of 0. Output problem. In this case, 0 could be 0 or 180. So that we only have one tangent to 0, and we don't have some undefined mess in the middle of our angle, negative 90 to 90. Does that make sense? If it doesn't, you just memorize that the inverse tangent's outputs come from negative 90 to 90, you're in the positive tangent. But I always like to have an answer to why for myself. So, again, we're going to take a guess on this one. Inverse tangent of a negative 30. Take a guess. Would your guess would be about what angle has a tangent of negative 30?
Thank you.
that? Okay, so let's say negative 70, I think it's closer to negative 70 or negative 80. Kind of imagine a triangle. Okay. So a lot of times you negative. The ratio of the opposite to the adjacent is 13. After 15?
Yeah.
Then it's just all like in between 89 and 90. So what Reese is saying is at some point like you can get really big tangents, but these are gonna be really big angles, but not quite as big as 90 or negative 90, depending on if you're talking about a positive or negative tangent. So like the inverse tangent of 15, that's going to have to be an angle that's bigger than 85.6. How big will it be? 86. That would be an inverse tangent of 25.7. Inverse tangent of 50.8.
Like 70.
70. Inverse tangent of 70.
89.
Get past 70, then all of those angles that have something, some tangent bigger than 70 are going to be between 89.1 and 90 degrees. And no matter how big this tangent is, okay, so when I put the inverse tangent of 400 million, what angle do you think that would be? Now I'm going to hit enter, and it might say 90, I just want to prepare you for that, and I'll just get to start. But that'll only mean that we kind of broke the top. Not actually 90 degrees. So 89.999, a bunch of 986. Okay. So, it's like you would expect. So the tangent can get as big as it wants, but all it is going to do is be really close. That angle is going to be really close to 90, but never quite getting there. Because remember, 90 doesn't have a tangent. There is no way to get 90 as an output. There are inverse trig functions. Let me give you a triangle solve. Solve that triangle. This is going to help about solve for all the things we don't know. All the angles on the triangle are all the sides. I can do that too.
Let's do it. Show us how you got 7 points for them.
Should be numbers.
Tristan has here is 144 plus 9 is 153.
Yeah.
And then guess if you're counting.
No. On the table, the third of the table, the three third, three packet, the table back.
And just give you that. Well, 153, I guess, is 9 times 7. 9 times 7. The square root of 9 is 3, so that gets to come outside the square root, and 17 doesn't have the square root, doesn't have any factors that are have square roots, so it stays inside there. Last thing is, the thing that we love in algebra so much is solving equations, finding the variable of different word. A set of equations where we use a representation. So, an example, sine of theta equals sine of theta. Where the algebra comes in. If we take the inverse sine of the sine theta, their inverse functions, they cancel each other. Which is like if we take 3x, if we had 3x equals 17, we would divide both sides by 3 because times 3 and divide by 3 are two inverse functions. Get x equals 17 over 3. And if we add x squared equals 14, how do you get x itself? Take square root. Square root x equals plus or minus the square root of 14. Same thing here, take the inverse sine is log sine, which is going to be the same thing for both sides. And we wind up getting exactly what we inverse sine of 2/7 equals. Calculator is 5/7 of 2/7. So what do we get for that?
16.7.
16.7. Okay. Now, here is the catch. So let's write that original equation over again. The sine of some angle is 2/7. And then we got the inverse sine is the inverse sine of 2/7. Inverse sine of 2/7. Okay. Now these aren't identical. Why? When we take the inverse sine of 2/7, what kind of an answer are we going to get? What kind of answer? Or where's our answer going to come from? From the calculator. The calculator is going to give you a number. That number is going to be between 0 and 90, because we know that the sine is positive, and so between 0 and 90, we were kind of previously going to say between negative 90 and 90, somewhere in there. But the sine of an angle is 2/7. Does that mean that that angle is definitely between 0 and 90? No, because that angle could be anything. Right? So if that angle did turn out to be 16.6, then we're fine, but there could be another angle that has a sine of 2/7, right? Okay, so when we solve these equations, you kind of need to know where are these angles. Is it coming from 0 to 90? Great, then we found the answer. But sometimes they'll say something in addition, and they'll give you this, and then I'll tell you that the sine of theta is 2/7, and theta is between 90 and 180. Not between 0 and 90. And your calculator is going to give you 16.6 no matter how many different ways you try to input the inverse sine of 2/7, and that is the only way we can get an idea of what theta is. But it's going to give you this angle, 16.6, but it's stated in the beginning that the angle is between 90 and 180. How do we find, if we're given this by the calculator, an angle that has the same sine but here, between 90 and 180? And how do you get that?
90 plus 16.
So you're adding 16.6, that's not a bad idea. The one thing about that is, when we look around the unit circle, and we look at these coordinates right here, which one is the sine? This one is the sine. Right? So if there's an angle over here that has the same sine, it's going to be not just the same number of degrees away from 90, but it's going to have to have the same vertical, same y value. Right? So the sines are going to have to be the same. So how are we going to figure out what this angle is? There we go. We know that, obviously, these are like mirror copies of each other, that this angle is 16.6 degrees in size, and we just put that much of it in the neighborhood. So, we use the inverse sine to find an angle in the first quadrant that has a sine of 2/7, which is 16.6. So, this angle is also 16.6 away from the horizontal. So that angle must be So all we know from the beginning is that the sine of some angle is 2/7. And then the number of angles that have a sine of 2/7. So we've got to get some more information. Is it inside a triangle? Well, that the inverse sine of 2 is fine. Is it something else? Could it be bigger than that? Could it be a negative angle? That could be figured out. Okay. And that information will be given either explicitly like this, or is, you know, implied by other problems. So, handout 13.4. Going to solve this triangle. So what would you do? Solve this triangle. If you got the sides of it.
Or what do you feel like you can't
do? I would find the other one.
Okay, add these together, subtract it from 180. Go, tell me how big that is.
115.
115, yeah. That's the mental math around. We add those all up, should add up to 85 or 180, yeah, something like that.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, yeah. Okay, now what? Okay, so, I mean, it just remains to be seen by itself, right? But opposite over hypotenuse, always for every triangle? Do you remember at the very beginning when we started saying sine is adjacent over time? The adjacent over hypotenuse, opposite over adjacent, all that kind of stuff only works for a certain kind of triangle. Right triangle is not a right triangle, right? 90 degrees. One of the angles is to be 90 degrees. Which is, none of them are, so all of that is out the window. No Pythagorean theorem, no sine equals opposite over hypotenuse, no tangent equals opposite over adjacent, none of that stuff applies. Rolling your eyes, is that not working?
No.
Then, what do we do about it? We use something called the law of sines. The law of sines is, the law of sines is the law of cosines. And the law of tangent. The law of sines and the law of cosines is all we need to solve any triangle we call a scalene triangle. Mm-hmm. Or not right triangle. scaling would be where all the sides are different from each other. That's a lot of trying. So the law of sines says this. The sine of A is kind of important. This is a capital A, capital letters represent angles. Over A, okay, so here's the thing. A, capital A is an angle. Like, let's say that this is A. Then, what one side would you call A? Because this represents a side. Call C A? Why? Because it's next to it? But this side is also next to it. But there's only one that's across from it. So we'll call the side that's across from A, opposite A, also a side. So the sine of the angle A over the side A, which means the sine of an angle over the side that's across from it, is equal to the sine of some other angle over the value of the side that's across from it. We can call this one capital B, and this one B. And that would also be the sine of C. So basically, the sine of an angle over the side across from it is equal to the sine of any other angle over the side across from it. So now that we know that, I mean, we remember that we cannot use the Pythagorean theorem, can't use opposite over hypotenuse or anything like that. We have to use the law of sines. If it applies.
So we need sine of 30 over the sine of 90. Or not, over 3.
Just over 3,
yeah. That's equal to sine of 35 over B.
And these two equal signs are here just to show you that any of them can be set equal to any other. You don't need three different things. You don't need two equal signs. So there it is. There's an equation that leaves B as the only unknown value. So now we have to get B by itself, which we should be kind of slow and careful about. Because so we don't want B to be in the denominator. Don't want B in the denominator. We'd like to cancel out the B that's in that denominator. How would I cancel out that B? It's just a number. You cancel this number out, so we cancel the
number.
We can multiply by B over the sine of 45. But then it'll multiply. Like, all I'm trying to do is something with B in there. I don't have to multiply. I don't have to have sine of 45 in the denominator, right?
So B in the denominator.
Or we could just, how about if we just multiply by B over 1? So on this side we get no b's. On this side we multiply by b, but now it's a b in the numerator. That's good for us. So now b is now not in the denominator anymore, and now we just want to cancel out the sine of 30 over 3. Right? So we'll multiply 3 over sine of 30 on both sides, and we cancel this out. On this side we get b equals sine of 45 is what we have left here times. What's 4.24? What about the triangle 4.24?
Lowercase
e, this side right here is 4.24. How will I find this side? Yeah, we're doing the same thing. Like the temptation now is we have two sides of the diagram here on the side of that triangle. We're going to set up the same kind of equation, but we're going to use it to solve for c. So now, like pick this one?
Yeah.
Well, since it was just a rounded to 4.24, is that as exact as if we used 3 and 30? And seeing how we ran into this b, or the variable in the denominator problem, we could, if the sine of a over a equals the sine of b over b, then a over the sine of a equals b over the sine of b, like if two fractions of each other are reciprocal, we could do this, c over the sine of 105 equals 3 over the sine of a. This side compared to this side and this side.
If it's isosceles,
then two of the angles would be the same.
Two of the angles.
But no, it's not. Okay. Should it be the bigger side? I can tell. Well, what if I drew this really funky? It's across from the biggest angle, right? An angle is kind of like the openness the two sides are to each other, and so the side across from that must be the longest side. Which helps us decide, when we do all this, then we get some number that we got 1.3, we get something somewhere. If we get 10, we got you ready to do it? 5.79. Two people get 5.79? Three? Two people. 5.79. So that, the information that I originally gave you, if you remember,
maybe I won't remember,
was that this was 30, and this was 45, and this was 3. So this is what we call a side-side angle. I gave you two sides and an angle, right? But that would be different from a side angle side. Or sorry, side. I gave you two angles. So that was, an angle, side.
Which is different from an angle, side.
Angle. And it just has to do with, what is the orientation of this, of these things to each other. So this was an angle, side, because I gave you two angles that were right next to each other, and the side was not between them. It was the angles are right next to each other, and then the side was to by itself. Angle, side, angle would be, if I told you this was 30, this was 45, and this was 3. It would be an angle, the side of between two angles, and the angle. That would be angle, side, angle. This one that I gave you was angle, angle, side, because I gave you this, and this, and this. So, angle, side, angle would be so we're going to find this angle, right, by doing what? 180 and subtract those. have an angle and the sine is across from it. And so now I can start solving in one shot.
Just so you know,
this angle, the biggest angle in the hypotenuse, will always call C. That's fairly common, that's pretty much the standard. Especially when we get into the next one. So here we are, we've got an angle and an opposite side, and we're trying to solve for, say, let's call this an A and this one an A. Let's take my thing that I don't know, put it in the numerator, over, what's that going to go over?
47 first time.
Sine of 47. That's going to be equal to 6. Now, this gets more complicated and a little bit more tricky, but not yet, not on the homework. It's going to be straightforward. Set up your equation, solve for the unknowns, you get the way up. Okay? So that means we're just going to do this part, just that. Okay. We'll do the rest.